Good day. Crysis. Crysis is a game made by Germans in 2007. After a very productive cooperation with Ubisoft, Crytek lost literacy and rights to Far Cry franchise. Ubisoft ported Far Cry on consoles and went on to make multiple sequels with superpowers and shitty anime storylines, while adding absolutely gorgeous graphics, which definitely looked better than any other game from feudal Japan. Infused with kimchi, Crytek thought, hey, let's make our own Far Cry sequel with superpowers and shitty storyline, while adding absolutely beautiful graphics, which look actually good, and they delivered. It was a PC exclusive in the year when Steam was not popular yet, which is why the sales were disappointing due to piracy, and further games were made with consoles in mind first and foremost, and their unskippable intros scared away too many potential customers. Since then, Crytek were constantly on the verge of bankruptcy, because they had to spend all their money on a linguist who helped them avoid other mistakes in game titles. Crysis is a shooter with elements of Jet Ski Simulator, which celebrates the main ideas of Far Cry. Good graphics, ahead of time technology, wide open levels, brain-damaged AI with accuracy and reaction time going beyond the light speed, and turning into shit somewhere along the way. The original Far Cry was good when you were fighting people, because they gave you enough decent challenge, while also being balanced by chaotic stupid alignment, making combat entertaining. And, generally speaking, who doesn't like fighting people in post-apocalyptic world of the third millennia? But for some reason, Far Cry started to suck right after the first one-third of the storyline, and didn't stop until New Dawn. Maybe the reason was that the developers added mutants, which were very strong and resilient. Crytek learned their mistakes, and Crysis was made vice versa. It started to suck when they added aliens in the last one-third of the game. That is progress, I think. Which didn't prevent the last one-third of the series from sucking. In Crysis, you play as the Nomad, a member of the Raptor team. A Raptor team is a group of paraplegic special ops, who have to wear special ops nanosuits, which give them maximum armor, maximum strength, maximum speed, maximum camouflage, maximum additional pair of hands, and addiction to WD-40. All of these things have some more or less obvious capabilities. For example, maximum speed lets you move and reload faster. Crawl? Like that? Maximum armor helps dampen the damage, including fall damage. And maximum power helps you destroy Korean property, dampen the recoil, swim on a boat beyond the boundaries only to get eaten by a shark, and throw frogs beyond space and time. Nanosuit is not exactly power armor, more like a considerably more powerful armor. And if it was, it would be a Fallout 3 fragile kind. As we learn in future games, Nanosuit is actually based on an alien technology of intergalactic calamari. Unknown to the recipients of the suit, it biologically adheres to their bodies, creating a symbiosis. As a result, the process of removal of the suit is extremely uncomfortable. It either causes a gruesome, painful death, or, in case of Psycho, a midlife crisis. So, even if the suit is given to a non-paraplegic, it will make them paraplegic. By the end of the third game, the suit has fully consumed the main character of the second game. Thus, all what is left of him is probably the skeleton and a lot of organic liquid, which, according to chemistry, is called bukkake. Each member of the Raptor team is named depending on his area of expertise. Thus, Psycho is the warhead of the team, while also being a designated marksman. Prothet is actually Moses and survives a nuclear warhead. He also sold me my totally legit Crysis 2 copy, for which I am thankful.
And now have full access to your systems. Initiate phase 1.
Nomad is the main character who travels a lot and does everyone's job before dying in a shitty comic.
Nomad, Nomad, Nomad,
Nomad, you take care of those tanks, Nomad.
Nomad, Nomad, Nomad,
come on, Nomad.
Nomad, Nomad,
Ramirez.
All right, Nomad, living up to your name, I see.
He's a psycho.
And Aztec and Jester die at the beginning.
I saw him up close, boss. He was mutilated, ripped in two. I mean, what are we dealing with here? Cause it ain't just Korean.
Jester's right.
If this Rosenthal guy was a proper nut, we wouldn't be here!
Cut the crap, Psycho! You've all been fully briefed. Our job is to find those people, and that's what we're going to do. We're moving out now, and that's in order.
Something's here! It's got Jester!
We have to go! We have to go now!
Depending on the difficulty, the abilities of your enemies and your nanosuit change. On easy and normal, you're almost immortal, and your enemies have intellectual and combat capacity of a child of inbreeding, or English parents. On hard, you die quickly, have to use all the tactical abilities your suit gives you, and enemies shoot pretty accurately, while still having an uphill battle against evolution. It is exceptionally interesting to watch how they bug out, get stuck, fall on corpses, or run at each other while looking for you. If clones in fear were asked to pretend to be clever and took it to the heart, enemies in crisis were never asked to be stupid, they're just natural at it. On Delta, your maximum armor becomes a unique nanocloth mod, which is so thin that you could have soaked more damage without it. Enemies are still pretty damn stupid, but they have accuracy of a Finnish sniper on Pervitin, and also lose knowledge of English language, just like the developers. Delta lets you experience the whole Ultra Special Ops experience, which was designed with knowledge taken from various historical events and from CIA specialists. Also, on Hardened Delta you can't shoot the turrets while driving cars, making them absolutely useless for something other than skipping outposts or suicide bombing. Transport in this game is absolutely broken. It can consume a lot of bullets, protect you from damage with Orion Success, and has absolutely insane physical model created by the best minds of the planet, contested only by Garry's mod. The more I played Crysis, the more I used them to explode rather than travel around. Besides the cars and nanosuit, your main instruments are the weapons. There is not much variety. Pistols, which you never use. Fists, which you use even less. SCAR Assault Rifle, which you use rarely due to lack of ammo. AK-47, SCAR but made in Chinese sweatshops, so weaker and has a lot of ammo. PSG-1 Sniper Rifle, which is essentially pointless, since you can install a sniper scope on assault rifles and there is no bullet drop. Grenades, C4, Rocket Launcher and Laser Guided Missiles. A Gauss Rifle, which is a sniper rifle but actually fun and destructive. An SMG, which is worse than assault rifles. And a shotgun, which works well only in conjunction with camouflage and rarely with maximum speed due to its extremely wonky effective distance. Naturally, you will use assault rifles for the most part because everything else is made obsolete by them due to their amount of possible upgrades and ammo, including incendiary. Except for Gauss and minigun. Then, on the second playthrough, I accidentally hit X and changed the mod to Narrow, which turned the almost useless weapon into a Doom level shotgun, which I almost never changed until the end of the playthrough. It kills nanosuit guys in one hit, and one of the bosses in three. Once, it gave me 2 for the price of 1. Overall, all these things provide you with a decent level of tactical freedom. You can snipe enemies from far away. You can carpet bomb them by shooting multiple guided missiles into the air. You can approach them with camouflage and a shotgun, turn off the camo for a split second, blast them in the face and hide back. The artificial idiot can't establish causality between a man in black appearing from thin air with a shotgun, a sound of a shotgun shot, a newly dead compatriot and a man in black disappearing back into thin air. You can speed up and jump out of the cars, which turn into explosive piñatas. You can pick enemies up and punch them in the face to death. Finally, you can shoot your enemies with an unlimited amount of sweet, sweet CIA sedatives. But who are you fighting? Who are the enemies of humankind, in the opinion of a statistically average German game developer? Well, you already know the answer. The danger for the planet Earth. Nuclear weapon enthusiasts, who have strong ideological indoctrination. The worst spook to the Western culture, the ones who often try to solve their problems by throwing surplus people into them. The North Koreans. Starved on a diet of soup and chopsticks. North Korean General Kyung arrived on an island of Lingsheng and excavated a temple, which turned out to be an ancient alien ship, which in turn let a bunch of frost matrix sentinels out and covered the whole island with multiple ice barriers and a frost nova. unlike North Koreans, aliens are resilient, even less clever, extremely fast, and are not even remotely as fun to fight as North Koreans. Which is sad, because they are your only enemy in the last 2 hours of the game. You also get to use their ice weapons, which shoot icicles and have unlimited ammo. Do you know what happens when you shoot a perpetual ice generator in a territory so cold that everything freezes to the point of being indestructible? It overheats. And the best enemies are Korean nanosuits, but they're mentally challenged to provide any real challenge. Also, in one point in the storyline, they capture you by a punch in the face and want to execute you. Suddenly, an explosion of energy from the temple burns them, overcharges the suit of the General Kyong, and breaks everything but armor, and reboots your suit. Why so? Well, their suits are bootleg. In the end, you start doing absolute shit, like luring enemies in houses only to watch how roof collapses on them. Pretty damn fun. The more you get used to the AI and its strange ways, the more setups and more ways to abuse it you find. If you're not creative, it is always great to shoot at good ragdolls, which don't fall down like a bag of potatoes. And then you have cheat codes, my boy. How about unlimited laser-guided rockets? Also, the physics engine is absolutely mental. Whoever programmed it must have been doing the same Roads of Bliss Mark Kirkbride did while writing the Elder Scrolls lore. So, you can see insane stuff happening. Chaos is not a ladder, it is a spinning car or corpses which disintegrate after getting stuck in you. I think that physics should be in many more combat-heavy games, since it either makes fighting more pleasant and immersive, or adds some dynamics and thought to more frantic games where it is easy to forget about your surroundings. Nothing freshens your mind as a roof falling on your head. Or an alien. The story is pure shit. Go there, shoot Koreans, shoot aliens, watch a dramatic scene where a random general you almost never knew died, send nukes, that's it. Also, Kyong lost because he didn't listen to the scientists. Later on, Americans don't listen to scientists too. Helena tells about how aliens feed on energy. Yeah, okay. How about bringing a giant alien on the nuclear carrier where it tries to restart and most likely sends a signal to an even bigger alien? Or how about sending a nuke right into an enormous battery pack, which is the alien sphere itself? Right after Helena reminds you that they strive on energy. Absolute madman. Everyone in this game must have a personal vendetta with common sense or something. You definitely don't play this game for writing. You play it for gameplay and graphics. Like many other tech demos, Crysis has a lot of attention to detail. You can quickly destroy helicopters by shooting at axes, and tanks get more damage when shot at from the side or behind, and barrels actually leak fuel. When in zero gravity, recoil pushes you back. Everyone knows about cutting the palms, but besides that, you can break stalagmites in the alien ship piece by piece. Finding these small things is fun and unexpected most of the time. And if you pay enough attention, you can notice a giant Ceph submerging into the water in the direction you are retreating. What is done really well is the sense of scale, running on an island only to see it nuked. Seeing from afar a giant mountain falling apart to actually getting inside and then right under it to see the actual size of the alien ship inside. Running around an aircraft carrier to see an alien which dwarfs it and then a whirlpool which consumes them both. Running away from the expanding frost sphere and seeing it getting even bigger from afar. All that stuff is exceptionally breathtaking. Really helps the immersion. The only thing they miscalculated is the size of the island in the first mission. It needs to be approximately 2 times bigger than that to cover all the lands of the missions. In the end, it's just a solid shooter. Nothing more, nothing less. On the lower difficulties, you are the walking tank you are supposed to be, according to nanosuit ads. On Hardened Delta, enemies kill you pretty quickly and make you actually play carefully. Or so you think, before you get to the core, feel the gameplay and start using and abusing everything you have in your arsenal. You become the Shadow of Death, the Harbinger of Apocalypse, the Titan of Sathurin. They are Koreans, a horde made of rice and water. But you will be worse. Rip and tear until they call a brand of rice after you. Look at this guy, you can almost see the dirt in his pores. Haven't seen something like that until DMC5. To this day, Crysis holds up pretty well, and in fact, some people still remind everyone of how good it was and how it makes other games suck in comparison. GTA 5, you have Crysis. Red Dead Redemption, you have Crysis. Far Cry Vietnam, you have Crysis. Minecraft, you get the idea. What it doesn't hold up against is stability, or lack thereof. Years ago and now, I've always felt that urge, that bestial desire to crash or at least freeze, which happened a few times. When I was recording, and my laptop is not very strong, it was even worse. Funnily enough, Crysis 1 is way more stable on older, higher frequency, lower amount of cores and FRED CPUs. Because Crytek thought that in future, CPUs would have higher frequency, not more cores. And there are various bugs and other instabilities, like your mental one after flying for some time in the blue-gray alien ship. It is pleasant visually, but a very damn boring level where you shoot blue octopi. At least you can choke hold and punch them. You can punch everything, in fact. I really hope you liked this video. If you did, like, subscribe, maybe write something. More content is to come soon, so stay tuned and share my stuff. Thank you for your time, and good evening. Whoever made it necessary to press button to pick up ammo in the grass at night has no heart.